Dear all, welcome to the University of Oslo, and welcome to this beautiful room, the University Aula, with its 250 square meters of monk on the walls. It's also a great pleasure to welcome Professor Raj Chetty, professor of economics at Stanford University. At his young age of 37, Professor Chetty has already managed to establish himself as one of the most cited economists in the world. In 2008, that's 8 years ago, Chetty was by The Economist and The New York Times listed as one of the top 8 young economists in the world. And that's, as I said, 8 years ago, and that's impressive to say the least. Professor Chetty is here in Oslo, invited by the Norwegian think tank Agenda, in cooperation with the University of Oslo. We have, this is the third on the row of guest lectures, and we have, and it sort of are starting to make up a series, and we have had, and we have today, academic superstars like Thomas Piketty and Robert Putnam. And they have, both Piketty and Putnam have given us their perspectives on related topics as what we are about to hear today. Chetty will be focusing on questions like how can we improve economic opportunities for children growing up in low-income families? Not too distant from Putnam's focus on the American dream in crisis in his book, Our Kids. Your path may also have crossed at Harvard, where you used to be a professor, and Putnam still is a professor in political science. The topic is, of course, of interest for Norwegians and people from the Nordic countries. The topics of inequality and social mobility are always at the core in our region. And we are, of course, following the presidential campaign in the US, so we have noticed that it's also a hot topic in the campaign. If you look around in the aula today, you'll see a full aula. All the seats are taken. And that's not every day. And we even have a long waiting list today of people who want to attend this lecture. And sometimes when we have very popular concerts, we have a full aula with a waiting list, but very, very seldom when we have academic lectures. So, Professor Chetty, your visit attracts a huge amount of interest, and some of us have already seen you on YouTube, and we are looking forward to see you live now. But before the lecture starts, I think I'll introduce the director of the think tank Agenda, Marte Gerhardsen. Varsågod.
Thank you very much, and welcome everybody. It's great to see you this morning. And it's a great pleasure and honor for me on behalf of Agenda to introduce Professor Raj Chetty. As you said, this is the third year in a row that University of Oslo and Agenda cooperate to invite an academic superstar to Oslo. Last year we received Robert Putnam, the father of social capital, and the year before, Thomas Piketty demonstrated how inequalities are on the rise and made the whole country discuss his economic models for months on end. This year, our fabulous speaker is a few years younger, yet already a highly respected and acclaimed scholar. In fact, I was told that all exams for master students at the London School of Economics include the question, what would Raj Chetty do? At Agenda, we've been asking ourselves that question for months now, and for good reason. Professor Chetty's academic record of accomplishment is no less than breathtaking. He finished his PhD at Harvard at 23. The same year, he became professor at Berkeley, professor at Harvard at 28, and professor at Stanford at 35. So either they grow tired of you quickly, or more likely, you are a highly sought-after economist. A few years ago, Chetty received the John Bates Clark Medal, perhaps the most prestigious prize in economics, along with the Nobel Prize, and maybe your next visit to Scandinavia will be to receive that medal. Professor Chetty, welcome. The floor is yours.
Thank you so much. It's really a pleasure to be here in Norway to talk about social mobility. As you'll see, Norway, I think, plays a very special role around the world in discussions of social mobility, and I really appreciate the warm welcome here to Oslo. So I'm going to start by talking at a very big picture about the American dream, which is a complicated concept that means different things to different people, but let's distill it to a simple statistic that we can measure systematically in the data around the world, which is the chance that a child born to parents in the bottom fifth of the income distribution makes the leap all the way to the top fifth of the income distribution. So this is the classic rags to riches version of the American dream. So how common is that in the United States versus a few other developed countries around the world where we have comparable data? In the US, 7.5% of children who are in the bottom fifth of the income distribution make the leap to the top fifth. That compares with 9% in the United Kingdom, 11.7% in Denmark, 13.5% in Canada, and also 13.5% here in Norway. Now, these differences across countries, when people see them initially, sometimes they react by saying, oh, even in Canada or Norway, your odds of success don't look all that high, right? Only a 13.5% chance of succeeding. But you have to remember, of course, that no matter what you do, you can't have more than 20% of people in the top 20%, right? And so relative to that, you know, bound, to put it more precisely, if we lived in a society where our parents played no role at all in determining our outcomes, we'd expect one-fifth of children to rise from the bottom fifth to the top fifth. That's kind of the maximum possible value you would expect this statistic to take. And so relative to that maximum, these are actually very large differences in rates of upward mobility across countries. The way I think about it is that your chances of achieving the American dream are almost two times higher if you're growing up in Canada or Norway rather than the United States. Now, these differences across countries have been the focus of a lot of policy discussion, and they've generated a lot of worry in the United States that it's no longer the land of opportunity as it was classically perceived. But what I'm going to focus on here today is that upward mobility varies even more within the United States. And I think relative to the cross-country comparisons, there are lots of differences, you know, between Norway and the US and Canada and the US. There's a limit to how much you can learn from such comparisons. So I think you can actually learn more from the set of facts I'm going to present about how upward mobility varies at very local area levels within the United States. In recent work with my colleagues, we calculate upward mobility for every metro and rural area in America. And we do that using de-identified information from tax and social security records on 10 million children, basically all children born in America in the early 1980s. This work is an example of an important broader trend in social science, which is the use of big data, if you'd like, to improve evidence for policymaking. Much as big data is transforming the private sector, allowing companies like Google and Amazon to offer better products, our vision is that such big data, as you have here in Norway, actually, Norway's a leader having these types of administrative data, can really have a tremendous effect on our understanding of economic policy. So using that data, we construct this map here, which shows you the geography of upward mobility in the United States. So this map shows the same statistic that I started out with. Your chances of reaching the top fifth of the income distribution, conditional on starting in the bottom fifth. And I should note the children are ranked in the national income distribution here. So we're saying, what are your chances of reaching the top fifth of the national distribution, conditional on having parents in the bottom fifth? And so for each of these 740 metro and rural areas, we take the set of kids who grow up in that area and compute the fraction who reach the top fifth. And the map is colored such that lighter colors represent areas with higher levels of upward mobility. So you can, if you take a look at the scale, you can see that there's a remarkable amount of variation in upward mobility within the United States. So if you look at the center of the country, for example, the lightest colors, you see rates of upward mobility exceeding 16%, higher than the numbers we saw, in fact, for Norway and Canada. At the other end of the spectrum, you look at places like Atlanta, Georgia, or Charlotte, North Carolina, much of the southeast of the US, you have numbers below 4.5%. lower than any country for which we currently have data. So just within the United States, you have this incredibly broad spectrum in rates of achieving the American dream, where some parts of the country can really correctly be described as lands of opportunity, and other parts are much better described as lands of chronic poverty, unfortunately. So you can see for yourself what the broad patterns are, but let me point out a few things that I think are interesting. First, you have some of the highest rates of upward mobility, both in the center of the country, which interestingly is where you have a lot of immigrants from Scandinavia, so maybe you just bring high upward mobility with you when you come. But in addition, you see high levels of upward mobility in the West Coast and East Coast. So for example, San Jose is the Bay Area, Silicon Valley, where I'm from. And you see rates of upward mobility actually quite comparable to the levels you're seeing in Scandinavia today. So while your eye initially gravitates to this broad regional variation, there's also much more local variation. So let me give you a couple of examples. So if you look at two states in the Northeast, Ohio and Pennsylvania, which are two states that we think of as having relatively similar economies and demographic structures, Ohio has very low rates of upward mobility, while Pennsylvania, places like Pittsburgh and Philadelphia, have much higher rates of upward mobility. So even across relatively nearby similar places, we see quite substantial differences. Let me point out one other example that I think might be of interest here in Norway as well. If you look at the middle of the country, so you see to the left of Minneapolis, which is labeled there, you have South Dakota and North Dakota, which generally have very light colors and very high levels of upward mobility, with one set of exceptions, which is the lower left corner of South Dakota, where you see some of the darkest red colors on the map. So what are those places? Those are some of the largest Native American reservations in the United States, where we know historically there's a lot of chronic poverty, and you pick that up very clearly in these data. So in the big map, you naturally focus, you know, on these broad patterns. But what I want to point out next is that you continue to see substantial variation as you zoom in to finer geographical areas. So my intuition is that even within a smaller country like Norway or even within the city of Oslo, I suspect you'd find quite substantial differences in children's rates of social mobility. And so to illustrate why I think that's likely to be the case, here we're showing you the data for the New York City metro area by county. So this essentially corresponds to the boroughs of New York. So you all know Manhattan, the Bronx, Queens, etc. So for each of those areas, we're taking the kids who grew up in each of those counties and asking what fraction of them make it to the top fifth of the national income distribution. And even within New York, there are really substantial differences in rates of mobility. In Manhattan, for example, you have a number of 9.9%, but you go a few miles over to Queens, and that number jumps to nearly 17%. So we find this in all cities in America, even relatively narrow geographies, there are really substantial differences in rates of upward mobility. So naturally, the question of interest to us as academics and to policymakers is to ask why upward mobility varies so much across areas, and what ultimately we might be able to do from a policy perspective to increase rates of upward mobility, both in the US and more generally around the world. What can we learn from these data? So the first result that I want to show you here is that most of the variation in upward mobility that we're seeing in these maps is driven by differences in childhood environment. So you might have thought, maybe this is about differences in the types of jobs in an area or labor market conditions or unemployment rates or taxes or things like that. In fact, it seems like the critical differences seem to be in childhood environment. So let me show you how we arrive at that conclusion. We study 5 million families that move between areas in the United States. And rather than getting into the details of the statistical analysis, I'm going to illustrate what we find with a simple example. So let's take a set of families that start out in Manhattan. And suppose, just to pick a round number, suppose if you grow up in a low-income family in Manhattan, on average, when you're 30 years old, let's say your income is $30,000. So if you grow up from birth in Manhattan, your income when you're 30 is, let's say, $30,000 on average. Now, consider a set of families who move from Manhattan to Queens, which, as we saw in the map I showed you earlier, seems to have better outcomes for children growing up in low-income families. So again, to pick a round number, suppose if you're growing up in a low-income family in Queens, if you grow up there from birth, you earn $40,000 on average when you're an adult. So now what I want to do is consider a set of families that move from Manhattan to Queens with children of different ages. And let's start by looking at families who move with a child who's exactly 9 years old. So why do I start with 9? That happens to be the earliest available age that we can look at in currently available US data. So if we look at these families who move when their children are exactly 9, and we track those children forward 21 years to look at how much they are earning when they turn 30, we see that they end up roughly halfway between the kids who grew up in Manhattan from birth and the kids who grew up in Queens from birth. That is, they're earning roughly $35,000 when we measure their incomes when they're 30 years old. So that's for the kids who move when they're exactly 9. Now let's look at the kids who move when they're 10, 11, 12, 13, and so on. And what you see is a very clear declining pattern here. The later you make that move from Manhattan to Queens, the less of the gain you seem to get from growing up in Queens. If you move by the time you're 20 or 22, you essentially get none of the gain at all. And if you move after that point, it's completely flat. There's no gain whatsoever from moving in early adulthood. So what do you see in this chart? I think there are three very important lessons to take away. First, you can see that where you grow up matters, place matters. It's not just that the kids who are growing up in Manhattan are different from the kids who are growing up in Queens. This is not about differences in the types of populations living in these different areas of the city. This actually shows you that if you take a given child and move that child to a different environment, that child can potentially do much better in a different environment. So I think that's a very encouraging lesson. It gives us hope because it shows that even in an era of growing inequality and persistent poverty, you can actually make a difference. You can actually change these outcomes. It's not just destiny. Second, you can see that childhood environment is really what's critical. Moving in adulthood doesn't do a whole lot for you. What really matters is moving when you're a child. And third, you can see that every extra year of exposure during childhood contributes roughly equally to better outcomes in adulthood. So what I mean by that is if you move at age 9 instead of 10, or you move at age 15 instead of 16, you continue to get roughly the same gain, about a 4% improvement in outcomes for every extra year that you spend in a better environment. Why is that result important? It's important especially in light of the current policy focus in the US and other countries on early childhood intervention. So there's a view that has emerged that you really need to intervene in the very earliest years in order to be able to influence children's long-term outcomes. These data suggest that that's not quite true. Even if you're in a better environment when you're a teenager or an adolescent, it continues to help you in the long run. So there's no reason to give up on kids after they're 5 or 8 years old. You know, childhood environment matters throughout childhood. Okay, so we see that where you grow up really seems to matter. So then, you know, the next question naturally is to ask, what are the characteristics of these high mobility areas? What is it that Queens seems to be doing better than Manhattan? What is it that's better about the Bay Area or the middle of the United States than other parts of the country like Atlanta, Georgia, or the Southeast? So this is where I think we can potentially draw some lessons from these data that we think would generalize to other settings, perhaps to Norway or to other countries more generally. So there are a variety of different factors that one might examine in analyzing these differences across places. I'm going to, in the interest of time, focus on 5 patterns that we've identified as the 5 strongest correlates of these differences in upward mobility across areas. And I'm going to start with segregation. We find that places that are more segregated by race or by income in terms of their residential structure have significantly lower levels of upward mobility. Now, there are many different ways in which you can measure the degree of segregation in a city from a statistical perspective. It turns out you don't really need to worry about what statistical measure you use because the patterns are so clear, you can just see them visually. So let me give you an example. This map here depicts racial segregation in Atlanta. The way it's constructed is using census data. Each person in Atlanta is represented by a dot, and the dots are colored so that whites are blue, blacks are green, Asians are red, and Hispanics are orange. So you can see immediately that Atlanta is an incredibly segregated city. The green dots are just completely separated from the blue dots. The white people in Atlanta live in a completely separate part of the city from the black people in Atlanta. Same for the Asians and the Hispanics. Now, what we find is that Atlanta and cities that look like this in terms of residential segregation tend to have extremely low rates of social mobility. Low-income people and minorities in those cities have much lower chances of escaping poverty relative to the rest of the country. Now, compare Atlanta to Sacramento, California, near San Francisco. Sacramento is a city that has the same fraction of minorities as Atlanta, the same fraction of blacks and Hispanics as Atlanta. You can see immediately that Sacramento is a much more integrated city than Atlanta, right? Look at the colors of the dots. They're just much more interspersed than what you saw in Atlanta. And corresponding to that, we find that cities that look like Sacramento in terms of residential structure tend to have much higher rates of upward mobility. So that's the first strong pattern we find in the data. Places that are more integrated tend to have higher levels of upward mobility. Now, what is the mechanism for that? You know, why do you find that correlation? There could be many different pathways. So one plausible pathway is that this is about exposure and peer effects and role models. So when you live in a city like this, you're not going to come into contact with people from more affluent backgrounds or people from different racial backgrounds. And that might influence your outlook on life or the, you know, set of things that you aspire to do. Another possibility is that this is about funding for things like public schools. So unlike in Norway, in the US, schools are funded based on local property taxes. And if you live in a city like this, your public school in your own area is likely to have much lower funding if you're in a low-income family or if you're in a black family than if you live in a more integrated environment like this. So we don't know exactly what the mechanism is. What we do know is that there's a really strong association between residential integration and rates of upward mobility. And I think that's a lesson that's very likely to generalize here as well. As you have a city with more immigrants, and you think about where these immigrants live, I think integration is really a crucial feature of communities that tend to generate high rates of upward mobility. Second, linking to the topics that Thomas Piketty talked about here a couple of years ago, we find a strong association between levels of income inequality and rates of upward mobility. In particular, places with a smaller middle class also tend to have less social mobility across generations. I think this link is very important because in the US political context, what you find is that there's quite a bit of debate about what we should do about inequality. Some people have the view that if some people are much richer than others, we should redistribute and share the, you know, the rewards of economic growth more equally. Other people have the view that if you made a lot of money on your own, then you're entitled to keep that money and we shouldn't necessarily redistribute it. Unlike the debate on inequality, there's a lot of consensus that we should have high rates of social mobility, that America is all about the American dream. You should have a chance of succeeding no matter where you come from. This second correlation suggests that there might be a link between these two factors. Places with more inequality, and perhaps as you have growing inequality over time, you're also going to have less chance for children from low-income backgrounds to escape their circumstances. And so that, I think, creates another reason, even if, you know, one is not concerned about inequality in and of itself, if you're concerned about social mobility, as I think most people are, you should then still be potentially quite worried about rising inequality in many countries around the world, including Norway. Third and fourth, the next two factors that we're going to look at come more from the sociology literature and connect to the work of people like Bob Putnam. So we find that areas that have more stable family structures, in particular areas with more two-parent families tend to have significantly higher levels of upward mobility. This actually turns out to be the single strongest correlation in the data. In areas with a larger fraction of single parents, we see lower levels of upward mobility. Now, in interpreting this correlation, a very important thing to note is that this is not directly driven by whether your own parents are married or not. It's a community-level correlation. And the way you can see that is if we look at the subset of kids whose own parents are married, so let's say you're growing up in a two-parent family, if you live in a community with lots of single parents, you are less likely to climb the income ladder. So it's not literally about whether your own parents are married or not. It's something, again, about community-level factors that are related to the stability of family structures or, you know, other correlated factors. The fourth factor is related to that, and it's the concept of social capital. So this, you know, links to the lecture you had here last year from Bob Putnam, and the idea that social capital is a key determinant of economic outcomes and might be declining over time. So the way I think about social capital is in the context of the old adage that it takes a village to raise a child. So even if you're not doing well, will somebody else in your community help you out? To give you an example, Salt Lake City, so a city in Utah in the US, is a city thought to have a lot of social capital with a large presence of the Mormon church. And corresponding to that, Salt Lake City is one of the places in the US that we find has the highest rates of upward mobility. Now, some of you might remember that Bob Putnam, my former colleague at Harvard, who popularized this concept of social capital, he did that in a well-known book called Bowling Alone. And the reason for the title of his book was that he used the number of bowling alleys in an area or whether people were bowling alone as a proxy for social capital, which is a notoriously difficult thing to measure in the data. So first of all, I was quite amazed to find in our own data, and I remember discussing this with Bob in his office, that the number of bowling alleys is in fact very strongly correlated with rates of upward mobility in our data. But the reason I mention that to you here is that it illustrates an important caveat to everything I'm showing you on the slide, which is that these are correlations rather than causal effects, right? So I'd be surprised if the policy conclusion you should draw from this is that we should build more bowling alleys to try to raise upward mobility. And so that is a caution, shows you kind of the state of research, the state of knowledge on these issues. We know what factors are correlated at a broad level with these differences in mobility, but you shouldn't take this as, you know, a recipe for what exactly you need to do in order to increase rates of upward mobility here in Norway or anywhere else. Now, the fifth factor is a little bit different in that regard. As you might expect intuitively, places with better public schools, as measured, for instance, by higher levels of expenditure, smaller class sizes, higher test scores, these kinds of places tend to have higher levels of upward mobility. Now here, unlike with some of the other factors, we have very clear evidence from our own research and other people's research that this is a causal relationship. Improving the quality of schools can really have profound effects on levels of upward mobility. And so I want to turn to that to show you what that evidence looks like and show you how powerful improving the quality of primary education can be. And so the study that I'm going to turn to here uses big data to study teachers' impacts. So what we do is we take information from school district records. We have data on all children who went to New York City public schools between 1989 and 2009. That's 2.5 million children. And those children over the 20-year period we study have written 18 million tests over that period. Okay, so you have this large data set, information on kids in school. And we link that data to data from tax records, so the information that I was using to draw the maps and the other results that I was showing you so far. So by linking those two data sets, we're able to ask a question like, how does the quality of your third grade teacher affect how much you're earning in adulthood, where you went to college, whether you had a teenage birth or not? So we can look at how early childhood education affects a variety of long-term outcomes. Now, what I'm going to show you is that the quality of teachers you have in childhood has really dramatic long-term effects. In order to do that, we first need to have a measure of teacher quality. We need to have some way to say this is a higher quality teacher and this is a lower quality teacher in order to establish that result, right? And so the measure that I'm going to use here is one that is of great policy relevance in the current debate in the US, which are test score-based so-called value-added measures of teacher quality. So the concept of teacher value added, while there's some complicated statistical issues in the background, is really quite simple. The idea is to ask how much a teacher raises his or her students' test scores on average. So for example, if I'm a third grade teacher, we'd calculate my value added by taking my students' test scores on average at the end of third grade, minus their test scores on average at the beginning of third grade or at the end of second grade. And if that number is very positive, we would say that I'm a high value added teacher. And if unfortunately it was very negative, then we'd say I'm a low value added teacher. Okay, so that's basically the concept of computing teacher value added. So the question we want to ask is, what is the effect of being assigned to a high versus low value added teacher on children's long-term outcomes, and how can improving the quality of teachers change rates of upward mobility? So in answering questions like this, I find it useful to step back and ask, what is the ideal scientific experiment that you would run if you could to answer this question the way a scientist would, right? And so the experiment you'd like to run here is to rate a set of teachers in a given public school based on historical data on their students, compute each of their value added. So, you know, using data from the past few years, rate every one of the teachers in the school and assign them a value added score. And then you'd take a new group of students and tell the parents, look, we want to answer this important policy question of whether teachers matter for children's long-term success. So we're going to conduct an experiment where we'll randomly assign some of your children to teachers we've identified as being high value added, and we'll randomly assign some of your kids to teachers we've identified as being low value added, and let's see how they do in about 20 years and look at their earnings. So as you can imagine, running that experiment in practice is extremely difficult, and that is really the challenge of social science, right? This is why a lot of economic theories are very debated, because we can't run experiments like this very, very easily. Now, having big data, the data set that I was describing here, really can allow us to make progress in resolving that problem. We can essentially approximate the experiment I just described in the data we already have. And so let me show you how that works with this illustration here. So what we're going to exploit is the fact that there's a lot of turnover within schools in the teaching staff. There are often different people coming in and going out in a given school over time, and that effectively recreates the type of experiment that I was describing. So to show you how this works, what we're going to do is track a given school in New York City, over time, looking at different school years. So we're going to look at fourth graders who get to that school in 1993, 1994, 1995, and so on. So these are different cohorts of kids, kids born in different years, who are getting to fourth grade in different years. And what we're going to do is plot average test scores in this school. I'm giving you an example of a specific school, but we're going to average over thousands of such schools in our data. And so we plot average test scores, and you can see that test scores are kind of hovering around the 50th percentile, around the median in the school over time. Now, what happens in the school is that at the end of the 1995 school year, there's a new teacher who comes in who's in the top 5% of the value-added distribution. Based on historical data, we've identified her as being one of the 5% most effective teachers. So what we're going to do is look at what happens to test scores right when that teacher comes in. And you can see that immediately, test scores jump up and continue to stay high as that teacher continues to teach subsequent cohorts of children. So that looks like, you know, this high value-added teacher really has a significant effect on these teachers' outcomes. Now, you all remember that in any experiment, going back to your you know, primary school science classes, in any experiment, you want to have a treatment group where something changes, which is what I've shown you here, but you also want to have a control group to make sure that nothing else changed at the same time in the school that might be contaminating this analysis. Now, in this context, there's a very natural control group, which is to look at test scores in third grade. The better teacher started teaching in fourth grade, but nothing changed in third grade, so we wouldn't expect to see any change in third grade test scores. And in fact, when you plot third grade test scores, you see that they're totally flat over time, exactly as you'd expect. So this type of evidence shows us that highly effective teachers really do have a significant impact on the amount their students are learning as measured by these standardized tests. Now, in this example here, I'm focusing on the upper end of the distribution, this really highly effective teacher who improves student outcomes. This works totally symmetrically in the opposite direction. If you have this teacher here who doesn't want to be there and is in the bottom 5% of the distribution of value added, he unfortunately immediately pulls down test scores relative to the prior year as soon as he enters. So this is totally symmetric across the distribution, okay? So these results here show you that teachers have significant effects on student learning as measured by these tests. But now to connect this back to the upward mobility discussion and children's long-term outcomes, what we ultimately care about, we repeat the same analysis that I'm showing you here, looking at impacts on college attendance rates, on earnings, and so forth. And rather than going through the details of that analysis, let me just summarize what we find with this hypothetical policy experiment. So let's suppose we take the bell curve of teacher quality, and we identify the teachers who are in the bottom 5% of the distribution, highlighted in the yellow here. And suppose we either give those teachers some training, or we hire new teachers such that we bring the quality of these teachers up to the average, up to the median level in the distribution. Okay, so that's a feasible policy change that we should be able to implement, at least by hiring new teachers. What is the effect of that simple change? Our estimates, based on the methodology I've just been describing, imply that this simple change would increase the lifetime earnings of the average child in the United States by $50,000. That is, having a teacher of average quality instead of a teacher in the bottom 5% for a single year in primary school would increase your earnings by $50,000. That translates to a gain of $1.4 million per classroom of average size in America, which is about 28 students. And if you discount that back to present value and view this as an investment at a 5% interest rate, that's worth roughly $250,000 in present value when kids are 10 or 12 years old. So you can see that these are very big numbers relative to teachers' salaries. Teachers have huge impacts on kids' outcomes. And moreover, you can see that improving the quality of teacher effectiveness, one critical aspect of the quality of schools, can really have profound effects on children's long-term success. We think that there are many more high-quality teachers in more affluent areas of the United States, and that could be why in some of these places in the US, you see significantly lower levels of upward mobility. So this, you know, I just wanted to illustrate is one really actionable way that many school districts are talking about in the US of trying to improve rates of upward mobility. So I want to present one final set of results that come at these issues of equality of opportunity and inequality from a different perspective, from the lens of economic growth. The traditional argument for greater social mobility or less inequality is based on principles of justice. So the idea that everyone should have a shot at succeeding, a shot at the American dream, no matter what family they happen to be born into. But what I want to show you now is even if you set aside that concern about justice and you are just interested in maximizing total growth, you're just interested in maximizing GDP, even then, you might still be interested in thinking about how to improve economic opportunity and improve rates of upward mobility. And to illustrate that point, I'm going to focus on one specific pathway to upward mobility, which is particularly relevant in Silicon Valley, which is innovation, inventing new things as a path to making money and contributing to the economy. And in order to study innovation, we're going to analyze the lives of 750,000 patent holders in the US by linking the universe of patent records to the tax data that I've been talking about. We use that linked data to first draw this chart here, which shows you how patent rates vary with parent income. So the way this is constructed is on the horizontal axis is parent household income. There's one dot for each percentile of the income distribution. And what we're plotting is the number of kids who go on to become inventors based on their parents' income level. What you can see is that there's an incredibly strong relationship between your parents' income and the probability that you become an inventor. If you happen to be born to parents in the top 1% of the income distribution in the US, you're 10 times as likely to have a patent as if you're born to parents at the median of the income distribution. So why is that? One possibility is that it's about the types of factors that I've been talking about in this lecture, differences in childhood environment, differences in schools, and so forth. Another possibility is that this is about differences in talent. Maybe the kids who are born to parents in the top 1% of the income distribution just have higher levels of ability because presumably their parents had to be fairly talented to get to the top 1% of the distribution. So we can discriminate between those two explanations by bringing in the test score data that I was describing earlier from New York City. When we use that test score data as a measure of ability relatively early in childhood. So to show you how that works, in this chart here, we're plotting the number of kids who go on to become inventors versus their third grade math test scores. On the horizontal axis, each dot here represents 5% of the test score distribution. So that last dot on the far right are kids at the top in the top 5% of their third grade math class. And on the far left are kids in the bottom 5%. And you can see there's a quite strong relationship between third grade math test scores and later outcomes in terms of your probability of becoming an inventor. In particular, your probability of becoming an inventor shoots up if you're in the top 10% or the top 5% of your third grade math class. As you might expect intuitively, the kids who are really smart and doing really well in their math classes in third grade are much more likely to become inventors. Now, more interesting and relevant to our topic today, let's replicate this analysis, cutting the data by parent income. So what we're doing here is plotting exactly the same thing, the number of inventors versus third grade math test scores, but now dividing the data between kids from low and middle income families in the blue, so kids from families below the 80th percentile, and kids from high income families in the red, families in the top fifth of the income distribution, above the 80th percentile. And what you see is a really striking pattern, which is that high ability children are much more likely to become inventors if they're from high-income families. If you're from a low-income family and you're really smart and you're at the top of your third grade class in the US, your probability of becoming an inventor is not all that much higher than any of the other kids. And so to put it differently, that shows you that in America, you seem to need two things to become an inventor. You need to be smart, as measured by your test scores, say, early in childhood, and you need to be from a rich family. And that, I think, gives you a very different perspective on equality of opportunity. It suggests that if we can bring some of these lower income, very bright kids through the pipeline to become inventors, not only is that going to help them in terms of having higher earnings themselves, it could also benefit the rest of us in the US and perhaps elsewhere in the world through the discovery of the next blockbuster drug or the next iPhone, etc. Now, to show you one final piece of data that connects this back to the geographic variation that I started out with and shows you what's going on here more precisely, this map here shows you the origins of inventors in America. So for the same 740 areas I was talking about initially, we're computing the fraction of children who go on to become inventors. And the red colors in this map are the hot spots of generating inventors, the places that create the most inventors. And so you can see, for example, Silicon Valley on the West Coast, very high fraction of kids who go on to become inventors, Boston and much of the Northeast. If you look in the South, you know, you have much lower rates of kids going on to become inventors, with one notable exception in Texas. That's Austin, Texas, where the University of Texas Austin is. So basically, these places where you have a lot of innovation already are much more likely to have kids who go on to become inventors themselves, which is consistent with the idea that exposure to innovation or exposure to a particular field while you're growing up really influences your life path. To see that more precisely, an even more striking result that emerges from this analysis is that the exact type of innovation that you go into is greatly influenced by the environment in which you grow up. So to give you an example, let's say we take two kids who are currently living in Boston, say they're both at MIT, and one of them grew up in Silicon Valley, has a lot of computer innovation, of course, and one of them, let's say, grew up in Minneapolis, which happens to have a lot of medical device manufacturers. What we see in the data is that the kid who grew up in Minneapolis is much more likely to have a medical device patent, and the kid who grew up in Silicon Valley is much more likely to have a computer's patent. And this holds at a very fine level in terms of the technological class in which kids innovate, showing you again that this is about childhood exposure. Why do we see this big gap in innovation between kids from rich families and poor families? The kids from rich families, you know, they have internships, programs in school, maybe parents, connections to the innovation sector. The kids from poor families, they might be very bright, but they're just less exposed to innovation. I think that's a major reason that you see that big gap in rates of innovation across levels of income. So let me conclude by talking about some broad policy lessons, and I'm sure we'll discuss this further in the panel as well. So the first broad lesson I draw from these data is that we should tackle upward mobility at a local and not just a national level. Usually conversations about inequality occur at the national level. The very term, the American dream, suggests that this is a country-level issue. But these data suggest that it's actually much more of a local issue. And I actually see that as a very encouraging message because it suggests that we can really do something about these problems through policy and through local action. It's really in our hands. Now, how can you go about doing that? I think you can either try to help low-income families with young children move to higher opportunity areas. So that's one approach, helping people move to opportunity, as I discussed. And here I would note two very important things in thinking about such a policy of mobility and increased integration. First, we find in our data that high-income kids do not do worse in more mixed-income areas. So often in the US, you see resistance to policies that try to create more integration by helping low-income families move to better areas from higher-income folks who think, oh, my kids are going to do worse if we have more integration like that. We don't find any evidence supporting that view. The high-income kids do equally well in mixed-income neighborhoods. Second, when you think of these high-opportunity places, they're not always the most expensive areas in a city. Often we find what we call opportunity bargains, places that generate really good outcomes for low-income kids, but are not necessarily that much more expensive than other places. And I think those places are really valuable places to increase integration. The second approach, of course, is you can't possibly move everyone. That's not a scalable policy solution. And so we also need to think about how we can invest in improving opportunity in parts of the country that have lower levels of upward mobility, improving the quality of schools, reducing segregation, and so forth. A second broad lesson that emerges from these data is that we should focus on improving childhood environments. A lot of the focus of the literature on inequality and the public debate is on jobs and trade and issues like that, which of course are very important. But I would argue based on these data that really focusing on the childhood environment if you want to improve social mobility is critical. And I'd emphasize that this is not just about spending more money. The US actually already spends more money, for instance, on schools than other countries, than Scandinavian countries, which have much better outcomes. Instead, it's about focusing on how to spend that money wisely, focusing on key inputs like improving teacher quality, or perhaps expanding in the US certain high-performance charter schools that have proven to be very effective. Then finally, I think at a broad level, as I hope I've illustrated here, harnessing big data to develop a scientific evidence base for economic and social policy can be extremely valuable. So we've made all of the statistics that I've been showing you here publicly available in the US so people can track how upward mobility is evolving in their own community in the United States. And we're working with government agencies to create a system to monitor local trends in inequality and opportunity, which I think is very useful, understanding exactly which policies are working and how you can maintain opportunity going forward. Let me end with this thought, which is, if you look in our data, you find that levels of upward mobility in the Bay Area for kids growing up in the 1980s looked quite high, right? So rates of upward mobility were comparable to those that you see in Norway, for example. But I think it's very important to note that you can't take it for granted that that's going to remain stable forever. And I think that's an important warning to keep in mind here in Norway, where things are currently very good in terms of social mobility, but it's very important to keep monitoring this going forward. And to illustrate that, I'm going to end with this by describing this article here in the Atlantic magazine, which came out a few months ago, where they asked the question, what does upward mobility look like for kids of the current generation in the Bay Area and Silicon Valley? Now, you can't answer that question directly, because we're only going to see the earnings of children who are currently growing up in the Bay Area in 20 or 25 years, right? But what you can do is take the five factors that I described, segregation, inequality, the quality of schools, and so forth, and make a prediction about what rates of upward mobility look like for the current generation by asking, how are all these factors trending? And in the Bay Area, inequality is rising, segregation is rising, the quality of schools is declining. And so what they end up concluding based on this analysis is summarized by the title of the article. They call the Bay Area the place where the poor once thrived. And I think that's a warning that is worth keeping in mind in a place like Norway. It's fantastic that Norway has such high levels of social mobility. I think it's very important to maintain that going forward by paying attention to these issues. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Raj, for a very inspiring and thought-provoking lecture. And I'm pleased now to invite... Is this working? Yeah. To invite the two other panelists to enter the stage. Please give a warm welcome to Hadia Tajik and Halvor Mehlum. I'd like to start by introducing you. Halvor Mehlum is professor of economics and vice head of Department of Economics at the University of Oslo. He's a board member at the Frisch Center, vice chair of the Center of Equality, Social Organization and Performance, ESOP, and his main research are areas of development, economics, and political economy. Hadia Tajik, she doesn't maybe don't need an introduction, but I'll give you one anyway. She's the vice leader of both the Labour Party and the Labour Party Parliamentary Group, and she chairs the Standing Committee on Justice in the Parliament. In 2012, she was appointed Minister of Culture and became Norway's youngest minister ever. She holds a degree in law from the University of Oslo and a master in human rights from the Kingston University, England, and a bachelor in journalism. So welcome to you. I would like to start with you, Tajik. A recent report from Statistics Norway confirmed that inequality is on the rise in Norway. And if we continue the present trend, we will be like the USA in 2050. However, as Chetty already said, we still have low levels of inequality compared to most countries. But if he was going to do his study in Norway, what do you think he would have found in terms of geographical differences and social mobility?
First of all, I would love for Chetty to do a similar comparison in Norway, because I'm sure there would be interesting findings. And if he can't, then please somebody in this room who I know have that kind of experience do that. That would be very useful for all the policymakers. That being said, if I were to guess what kind of findings he would find, based on the tendencies that we see, I think that we risk seeing that the traditionally egalitarian Norwegian society that we are used to having, that you would basically find that mostly not in the cities of Norway, but in the other more rural areas of Norway. Because what you see in some of the cities, especially in the city of Oslo, but you see some of the same tendencies in other cities as well, is a growing sense of inequality, both when it comes to income, when it comes to life expectancy. Oslo being the most extreme example, extreme in a Norwegian context, obviously, in an international context, if we're doing, I understand, quite well. But the tendencies are quite clear, and you do need policies and political initiatives. Some of them Chetty suggested or put forward, but you need policies in order to work against these tendencies.
But then it's appropriate to ask the academic here on the side. Listening to Chetty's research from the U.S., are there commonalities with Norway, and what do we know about differences between neighborhoods and social mobility here?
First, I want to give my applause, actually, for the great work you're doing with the big data in the U.S. And it is actually a challenge doing such research in the US because the data has not been available for that long. In Norway, we are in a different situation, and a lot of good research are being conducted and is definitely inspired by your research, will be picking up some of the issues that you are raising. So what do we know? We know that inequality is less acute in Norway compared to the US, and mobility is higher. That means that the mobility that we see, that the 13.5%, represents less of a leap in Norway than it what it does in the US. So even though it's more mobility, the mobility is less dramatic. So that's, I would say, a good thing. Succeeding in Norway is means that you raise your income 3-4 times compared to the alternative, but in US it will maybe be 10 or 20 times if you go really from the bottom to the top. So so what are the lessons that we get from the talk that is also relevant for Norway? I think what you describe about the school, that it's not really easy to get a hand on in Norway because of some regulation when it comes to testing and monitoring teachers and all that. I think what you, which could be good reasons for it, but anyway, the lessons that you, that we see from the US is probably relevant and important here. We see that the schools' qualities differ. We see that whether or not people go on to secondary education differs a lot between different parts of the city and also different parts of the country. But luckily, we do not see that huge wage differences resulting from whether or not you went into the most profitable segments of higher education. So again, the inequality, the underlying inequality means that these effects that you describe are not as serious in determining the incomes of people, but it could nevertheless be important in determining the neighborhood you are living in, the what kind of future your kids are having, and all that. But luckily, the income effect is not that drastic. Of course, it's there, but not that drastic. I was thinking about your effect on the teachers. If all educations, all the kids are getting a better education, you might expect that the premium from having a good education goes down. So to the extent that the market for labor works in the way that you have a competition for becoming the best kid, not a brilliant kid, but the best kid, and those who are losing out are the ones who are having the worst grades. If you have a competitive environment where it's not about the actual skill, but where in the ranking you are positioned, then, and I'm afraid that US have something like that, that even though you can help everyone, the relative position is really what matters. And in order to address the effect of relative position, then you need to do something with the labor market and compress the wages rather than having a competition for the admittedly 20% top wages that are only available for 20%.
Come in, Harry.
If you don't mind me saying so, I mean, we're all emphasizing that Norway is doing quite well compared to other countries, but then again, we have to remember being the person who does not succeed in a country where most people seem to succeed is quite a strong sense of not belonging and quite a strong sense of not succeeding, which relatively, again, makes it quite difficult for the ones who face these challenges. One of the things that Chetty mentioned was how important childhood good policies for a good childhood is, and it is my impression that this is becoming a more and more important part of the Norwegian political debate, disregarding any, you know, independent of which party you're in. And one of the things that we're discussing these days is early efforts in schools, tidlig innsats, and how to make sure that you are spending money more on the youngsters in schools, because you can identify quite early on which of the pupils who will be doing well in school later on and who will be struggling.
You want to comment?
Yeah, I was going to pick up on the other aspect of your comment on whether it's kind of a zero-sum game, where if you have one child having a better education, is it all about relative ranks? And so if I do better, does that mean somebody else is going to do worse? So based on the data that I showed you, you of course can't tell whether it's that one child is doing better at the expense of another child or not. But there are other studies which look at, for instance, compulsory education changes. So where everybody had to get an additional year of education, say in the United Kingdom or in the US. So in that kind of situation, if it really was purely a zero-sum game, you'd expect to see a significantly lower return to education, where everyone is simultaneously getting an additional year of education relative to just one child having a better teacher. But in fact, you find basically the same effect with these compulsory education reforms, where everyone is getting more education at the same time, which suggests, it's not necessarily definitive, but it suggests that at least a significant chunk of the return to education is not this relative ranking effect. It's that actually people are becoming more productive and earning higher wages, and that contributes more to the economy along the lines of the innovation example that I was giving you. So I think, you know, it's certainly a theoretical possibility, but empirically, it's encouraging, suggesting that, you know, this isn't just a zero-sum game.
And you also, the findings from your study, how particular are they for the US? Well, are they applicable for other countries as well?
So my best guess is that they'd be applicable to other countries, largely because we find these patterns I was showing you are very robust within different parts of the US. So the US is such a big and diverse country, you can almost think of it as a collection of a variety of different economic systems or different countries, if you like many different states, right? And all of the five factors I was showing, the various results I was showing, hold within each of the states, which suggests to me that this is a really systematic pattern. It's not just something that happens to be true in one case.
As you also said, intuitively, it strikes us as unfair that the size of your parents' wallet actually has a huge impact on your opportunities in life. But in addition to the notion of unfairness, there are some consequences for the society as a whole of low social mobility. You said a few words about it. I don't know if you want to elaborate a bit on that.
Yeah, I mean, I think in addition to unfairness, inequality has lots of different effects on... I highlighted one issue in the context of economic growth and innovation, but I think it really affects people's political attitudes. It affects health outcomes. There are a variety of aspects in which a society that's coming apart, where there are really people who are succeeding and people who are not succeeding, there are a number of dimensions in which problems arise.
And Hadia, from your perspective, why is low social mobility a problem?
Well, it's a problem both on an individual level, because you're losing out on opportunities and not getting the opportunity to really become the person you want to be. But on a more societal level, we're losing out on talent. We're losing out on economic growth. And you can see many examples of that. But just to pick one specific example, for the years to come, technological advancements will have a lot to say on all areas of society. And technological... works within that field. We've seen traditionally that it's been male dominated, and we risk in that sense, if we do not have the same kind of social mobility for women within this field, that we risk missing out on technological advancements that would be good for the whole population. One example we've seen with the Apple Watch that some of you may have read about a few years ago, that they made an application where they could monitor most health-related factors like sleep and what you eat and blood pressure, etc. It was just one thing that they hadn't kept in mind, and it was monitoring the female period. So basically, for 50% of the population, you would not get a real picture of your health situation, simply because the ones who made this application did not keep this in mind. And that's just a small area, but keeping in mind the technology, sorry, I'm a bit jet-lagged. I came from Tokyo just a few days ago. keeping that in mind, these advancements, it just makes it so important that we make sure that all parts of society are represented in creating the future that we need, because we might lose out not only on talent, but also on products and solutions that we need to create the societies that we want.
What are your reflections on this, Mehlum?
I want to... talking about the technology, the the trend with more robots and machines taking jobs, and so how to succeed in such a less where an environment where the workers are in less demand, then obviously everyone cannot be high-tech technicians. So you have to make sure that the future jobs and the and in the U.S., that the services that are still going to be carried out by real people that perhaps do not require such a lengthy education and not a patent or anything, that these jobs are paid a decent salary. So in the future, where there will be, as I said, the services will be in high demand. Some will operate the machines and earn from that. Other will do the taking care of the old, and these have to. There is something with, luckily, I think that in Norway we have a system where the wage of also the trivial services are well paid, and that's important. So if you are not among those who succeed in the math class, you get a decent job and you get a decent pay. It has been important before, and it will be even more important in the future. So the disappearance of the middle class might be something that follows from the mechanization and computerization of technologies that will pose some challenges for the U.S.
If I can just echo the point you made on technology and gender, I think that's absolutely right. We see in our data, that's another dimension of inequality that's very relevant. In the patenting data, for example, at present in the US, 15% of patents go to women. So it's incredibly gender imbalanced. Now there's better gender balance than there was 50 years ago, where only 5% of patents went to women. But at that rate of progress from 5% to 15% over about 40, 50 years, it's going to take another 150 years to get to 50-50 at current rates. And so I think that's extremely important for exactly the reason you said. Having more gender diversity, having more economic diversity in the set of people who are in different fields brings very different perspectives and is likely to lead to better innovations and different innovations that matter more.
To bring us back a bit to the social mobility, as last year Professor Putnam showed us how many cities in America are much more segregated now than when he grew up. And his hometown of Port Clinton, I think several in the audience would remember that lecture, had transformed from being a community where all the kids went to the same school, they played on the same football teams, and now it was a very segregated town. I think we could see it on your map as well, where the people don't meet across classes. What can explain this change in the town's actual intergenerational mobility in such a short time span?
There are a lot of forces in the U.S. that I think are contributing to segregation in many communities. So to take an example from where I'm from, in the Bay Area, the success in the Bay Area of the tech industry has generated a tremendous amount of wealth. And as a result, house prices have gone up as lots of people want to come to the Bay Area for high-paying jobs and so forth. Building of new houses hasn't kept up with that, and there are lots of restrictions on building, and you know that basically that supply problem creates rapidly escalating prices, which makes it very difficult for the service workers and lower income people to live in the communities where they used to live. And so as a result, you have this greater residential segregation, exactly as you described in Port Clinton, where people are living in completely different parts of the city. Some people are commuting 2 hours to get to their job because they can't afford to live anywhere nearby. And so that combination of forces, ironically, basically economic success has led to greater segregation because there hasn't been a suitable policy response.
And moving people to better neighborhoods contrasts with more typical Norwegian policies aiming at improving bad neighborhoods. Is there a trade-off of that? Or can we do both?
I think living in Oslo and seeing the property prices rising, I think a policy based on moving people to Oslo on top of what's already happening is actually a bad idea. Mm-hmm. And then you would have a ghettoification with or sheltered neighborhood effect. not the ghetto in the common usually sense of the word, but more like a rich ghetto with only wealthy parents being able to afford a house for the kids, and then the kids will stay in the area and go to this university and have a law degree and earn, I don't know, $1 million, and then reproduce this this inequality with the city taking off and leaving the rest of the parts of the country behind. So that I don't see that. I think the policy of moving activities and making sure that they're well-paid jobs also across the country is extremely important. And luckily, that has been the case. There are well-paid jobs in many parts of the country, so it's definitely possible to live a very decent life wherever you you live in Norway. And I think, and I hope it will continue. And I think, again, with technology, it's possible to have a job, maybe on the global scene, even working from anywhere in the country. And I hope that will continue.
Hadia?
The extent of social segregation that we see in some parts of or some cities of Norway, even though I do agree with you on how to tackle the social and economical perspectives of this, what I fear is that in some, well, being a youngster growing up in some parts of Norway or some parts of the city of Oslo of Norway, you risk not being exposed to all the opportunities you have in life. I mean, one of the things that you mentioned in your talk is how youngsters of low-income families do not become inventors, even though they may have the skills and the talent to become inventors, because in addition to the social and economical barriers, you have the mental barriers. You just do not see yourself in such a position. And growing up in some of the segregated areas of Oslo, you risk not seeing those images of who you can become. Just to give you a banal example, myself growing up, one of my friends, I met her many years ago. And the first time I met her, she said she was studying philosophy. She was doing an MA in philosophy, and I remember thinking, with my family background, like my parents are Pakistani, I come from a traditionally low-income family background, and I remember thinking, oh my God, you're studying philosophy. If I were to go to my parents and tell them that, you know, I'm going to do an MA in philosophy, it's not that they would say, I'm not going to let you, it's more that they would not take that seriously. That would not be, you know, a thing that I would be able to do. It wouldn't be something I would be able to think. And just exposing these youngsters to the ideas of what you can become is a very important part of what we have to do.
Thank you. I think one of the very interesting findings in Chetty's research is how much institutions and networks matter to children's opportunities. Networks, schools, government expenditure. And can institutions compensate for the differences in social economic background within a country? You said a few words about that, but would you please elaborate a bit?
Yeah, absolutely. I think institutions can mitigate these differences that we're seeing. So we see that when people move to a different area, they have really different outcomes, which shows that their environment is affecting them greatly. Mm-hmm. And we see that the environment seems to be strongly associated with mm-hmm. things like the architectural structure of a city, to what extent are the poor and the rich living together, to the quality of the schools, all things that can potentially be influenced, if not directly shaped, by intelligently designed policies. Mm-hmm. And so I think that is the encouraging message. You know, usually when you talk about inequality, a lot of the conversation is one of frustration and worry that this problem is getting worse and worse, and there's not, you know, what can we do about it? And I think this shows you that institutions mm-hmm. can really matter at a local level. Mm-hmm.
So there's some optimism in your research, actually. Hadia, as a policymaker, what do you take of kind of measures can you do on a local level to ensure more social mobility?
I think there's loads of measures that we can do. But one of the things that one of the things that I emphasize a lot is what you do see on the political spectrum on which I belong, on the left side of the political spectrum, is that we have a tendency to say that we have to facilitate opportunities that sort of make sure that the negative impact that your family background may have, that it does not become a part of your future. But in my experience, most families and most local communities want to contribute in a positive way, but in some situations they just don't know how to. So as a policymaker, I would be looking for ways to including the families and the local areas in contributing in a positive way to the youngsters in their communities. Take parents for one example. Most parents want to contribute in a good way, for example, when it comes to homework and such, but not all parents know how to do that. Some parents may think that they need to be very good at maths or very good in Norwegian or in the subjects that their kids are dealing with at school, but what you do know is that the parents need to do is just show interest. Show interest in their homework. Ask the kids, what have you learnt? Ask the kids to show you what they've been doing doing at school. And just telling their kids, signalizing that school is important, homework is important, is one of the most important things that parents can do. So it doesn't mean that the parents need a very high education themselves or need specialized answers for the questions that the kids are dealing with. Just being there more explicitly and empowering and enabling parents to do that for their children is as important as making sure that the schools are good enough for their kids and that the teachers are good enough for giving the kids opportunities.
From your research at the University of Oslo, what have how have you looked at the importance of institutions and social mobility?
Yeah, so that's been a major theme, or the theme of the research center that I'm part of, and looking at Norway and also looking at all the parts of the world, we are very concerned with how the institutional layout of the country and the labor market and the wage distribution interacts more or less in a productive way. And the case of the U.S. Is not only about inequality and education. Obviously, it's also about how people are left behind in the and not really making taking part in the political process, and that's an institutional problem. That means that many of the voices that would be all for subsidized education and subsidized secondary education and even subsidized university education at the broad scale are not really part of the political landscape. Luckily, in Norway, there have been a broad consensus that universal that education should be free and of the same schooling system for everyone. It's not the private option is not really there, and that's a virtue. Luckily, it has been supported by everyone. It has happened during a phase where Norway was going through transition from agriculture to more high-tech with the oil and money coming in and growth for everyone. So it was perhaps easy also in the late years to be in favor of universal systems. But if we are going into a future with less growth and where there will be competition to become the one who has success in a case where not everyone has success, it can be a challenge for the Norwegian system that might be resembled to some extent what the U.S. have been experiencing with huge fractions of the workforce not experiencing wage growth over the last, generation. If we get into a similar system here, then avoiding to be in that pool and stay in the pool that's still on the rise will be important and might lead some into less generous or support less generous alternatives.
Mm. So how can you ensure that?
I don't have good advice right now, but it's important watching. And do not look at U.S. as a very special place. They are inhabited by human beings that make their life go round. And it's not only about Trump. Trump is it's a symptom of something which is very deep and very important and very real. It's not only about language and dirty language. It's about real issues for millions and millions of people.
Madeleine Albright was in Oslo a few months ago, and I got the chance to meet her and asked, how could Trump happen? how could that possibly happen in the US? And she said, inequality. Would you share that view?
Yeah, I think a lot of the frustration that's leading to people supporting Trump, in fact, if you look at people's quotes directly in the media, a lot of people will say, you know, I'm not able to achieve the same standard of living that my parents did. I can't, you know, get the American dream. Donald Trump is going to change America, and maybe that's going to revive the American dream. I mean, what we've done over the past 30 years, the past generation, apparently hasn't done much, so maybe we try something totally different. So I absolutely think that that's a key part of what's leading to the support. Whether the set of solutions being proposed on the right are actually solutions that are going to revive the American dream is a different issue.
I know that you have been advisor, not so much for Trump maybe, but for Clinton. What is your main advice to her on what how she can improve social mobility in the U.S.?
So I've spoken with Hillary Clinton and members of the Clinton campaign and people on the right as well who are interested in seeing the evidence and what it has to say. I think the power of this kind of work is you can just present the data and there are some implications that follow regardless of your political views. And I think some of the implications that emerged that resonated with her were the emphasis on childhood environment and trying to change, for instance, housing policy, which traditionally is not something that people link to inequality, but we spend about $45 billion in the year on, per year in the US on various affordable housing programs. But that money is spent in a way that I think is not particularly effective, in the sense that the vast majority of affordable housing in the US is in these very high poverty, low opportunity areas. And so I spoke with her about various ways in which you might reform existing policies to enable more families to move to opportunity and also revitalize the communities that currently don't offer as much opportunity. So I think broadly, the focus on trying to improve childhood environments to tackle inequality and improve mobility is something that the Democrats and, you know, a number of Republicans are quite interested in the U.S.
You know, we've been following, of course, the campaign with a growing feeling of horror. And but even though, I mean, right now, we feel quite confident that Clinton will win, but still, Trump is a symbol of something. You wanted to comment on Trump, Hadia?
I just very much wanted to echo your point on how the populists, if I may use that word, about Trump and some of the other politicians that you see also in a European context, is that they are responding to real issues. They are responding to a reality that people are facing right now. Inequality is one of the things, but I mean, we have created our own populists in the sense that we did not tackle these issues properly. We have not to the people who are dealing with the downsides of inequality and the trends that lead to that, we have not been supplying them with the answers that give them hope for the future and believe that we can change their path. And not being able to do that is what have laid the grounds for some of these populist voices. And what makes me fearful and not hopeful is that having these populist voices is also reinforcing some of the inequalities that we see, that we do see around the world. But that being said, it's no wonder that some people do not trust us, the traditional politicians. We haven't solved their problems. And that's a part of the reason why you see a growth in the populist vote or the populist voices like Trump, who is promising them that there's something, a change will happen, there will be something else than the traditional political policies.
But are you pessimistic about the future, or do you think that the traditional parties will be able to respond better?
Being a social democrat, obviously I believe in politics. I believe that we can change. I mean, we can put forward policies and we can create change, but that being said, I'm not very... it is a glum future. It's a dark future. It's going to be very difficult times. We have created our own problems. We have to face them. We will win, but it's going to be very difficult.
Do you share that view?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think there are places that are doing well within the United States, for example. And I think with the right set of policies, the right set of politicians, these problems can be surmounted. And I think it's important to take a balanced approach in tackling these problems, and I'm optimistic that that will emerge over time.
There are many different opinions on how much inequality is acceptable and how much equality is necessary. However, I believe that everybody agrees that random things such as your parents, who your parents are, and where you, what your neighborhood is like, shouldn't really matter. And today's lecture has showed us, and the discussion as well, that they do. So I want to thank this very exquisite expert panel, and thank you, Professor Chetty, for sharing your research with us today. And I'd also like to thank the audience, and hope you've all been inspired to engage for a society with equal opportunities for all. Thank you very much.